Proverbs, but where we started in the book of Genesis, and the idea that we came across was this, is that God is love, and that he desires a creation that could reciprocate love to him. God desires to have, that's the only reason why he would create humanity. And one of the things that we realize is this, is that the way that creation took place, it became real clear as you began to see. He didn't make fish before he made water. Amen. He didn't allow trees to grow before there was land. He didn't make man until there were animals and plant life, because God was preparing a place for mankind to dwell, because God desired to have a relationship with man. And then we saw immediately after the creation, the terrible effects of the fall, how Adam took sin into himself, and how it spread throughout the entirety of the human race. But that we also notice this, that in the very beginning, as soon as the fall took place, immediately God spoke forth the plan of redemption. He told the serpent that the seed of the woman is going to crush your head. Amen. And then God clothed Adam and Eve with the skins of an innocent animal, signifying the day that the cross would come, that Jesus, the seed of the woman, would bear the sin of humanity as he died upon the cross, making reconciliation, or that separation that had taken place between man and God because of his sin, would now man would be brought back together through faith in what God had always planned. And it wasn't just going to be the seed of the woman, but it would be the seed of Abraham, amen, the seed of Judah, the seed of David, and the Word became flesh in the New Testament, hallelujah, and dwelt amongst us, and he was the one. It wasn't just the seed, but it was the sacrifice. And it wasn't just skins for the first couple, but it was a sacrifice in the book of Exodus for a whole family, and it was a sacrifice for a whole nation on the Day of Atonement, and it was a sacrifice when John the Baptist said, on the banks of the Jordan River, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Yes. Amen. Yes. But God's very specific. And he created a people. Amen. In the book of Genesis, we learned he called a man named Abraham out. He said, come out from amongst your father's house, and I will make you a great nation. I will bless those who bless you, curse those who curse you, and through your seed. Now, if we go to the New Testament, Paul tells us, he didn't say seeds as of many. He said seed as of one, that seed which is Christ. In other words, through Abraham, ultimately, we got Jesus. Amen. And through Abraham, God created the whole nation called Israel. And what you and I need to understand is that it was through Israel that God gave his truth. God gave his word. He allowed it to be chronicled in this book we call the Bible. He gave Israel the prophets. He gave Israel the law through Moses, and all of the oral tradition that started with Adam was chronicled with Moses in the law, starting from Genesis and Exodus and Leviticus and Numbers and Deuteronomy. And then from there, we enter into the time frame of the kings and the prophets. And the point I'm trying to make to you is that God is communicating to the world that he's real and that he has a people. And just as Israel as a collective group were God's people, Christian today, when he gives his heart and his life to the plan of God, is also the people of God. Amen. And that's you and I. And we have a rich history to look back on, and a rich future, hallelujah, with eternity with God. And God's looking for a family. He's going to create, he's going to cause a harvest to take place upon this earth, a harvest of souls. Yes. And God's wanting you and I to get involved in this. Amen? He's not wanting you just to sit idly by and just soak up a spot in a church. No. He's wanting you to give your life to him. Just as Jesus gave his life for you, God wants you to give your life over to him and let the life of God live on the inside of you, so that the love of God can come out of you and that people can hear the truth. Amen? Yes, we're fallen. Yes, this world is fallen. But I know a God who sent us a Savior. Hallelujah. And if you put your faith in him, he'll give you hope. He'll give you a new life. Amen. Hey, you got a hold of that Jesus yet?
Yeah.
You remember him? Praise God. Sometimes the preacher got to remind himself about that, right? Amen. Listen, you get so caught up in this daily grind, so caught up in this life and everything that's going on around you. Man, look, we're here for something bigger than ourselves. Amen. I'm telling you, this is just temporary. Amen. The future, hallelujah, is where, listen, today's just a dress rehearsal for eternity. Amen. So what we did was we went all the way through the book of Kings, all of bad kings that kept on causing the people of God to go against God, and went through 1st and 2nd Kings, and we got into 1st and 2nd Chronicles, and like I told y'all last week at the end of 2nd Chronicles, the last king Zedekiah, the last vision he saw, Jerusalem destroyed, his boys killed, plucked out his eyes, wrapped the chains around his neck, and hauled him off to Babylon. The next books were going to be Ezra, Nehemiah, and Esther. And we put those on the back burner because chronologically that comes after they get released from Babylon. So where we are now is in the wisdom literature. We've already covered in the wisdom literature Job. We talked about that was wisdom for the test. And then we went into Psalms. And in the Psalms, it's just so beautiful, right? We talked about the word psalm in the Greek, literally a solo, and it describes a stringed instrument with lyrical accompaniment. And it is a poetic form of God's word through the psalmist David or other psalmists that they would from their heart, they was writing poetry unto God. And you had to stop and you had to think, just like you have to think with the Proverbs. There's more to it. They would use imagery. They would use pictures, descriptive of a sword. And it wasn't even spoken of literally, but that it represented judgment or, you know, just various concepts like that. And the Psalms, there were so many different types of Psalms, prophetic Psalms, most of them connected some way back to Jesus. But at the same time, these people, these men, David, literally going through circumstances in the midst of their life, whenever people that they loved were coming against them, his own son Absalom and other people, and he's not even allowed to rule on the throne like he was called to, or, you know, he's been anointed king, and all of these things going on in his life, turmoil and tribulation. And what we learn from the psalmist is this: when it doesn't, whatever you're in the midst of, and that's one of the things that we got to the last thing in Psalm chapter 61, it talked about being thirsty for the things of God. And the last comment I made when we closed was this: all you need is a little bit of light in this book right here.
Yeah, man.
Hey, come on, somebody. It doesn't really, listen, I know that we've all been through some rough times, and I can assure you that there will be some more rough times up ahead. This world is still falling, but hallelujah, Jesus is still on the throne. Amen. And what I need you to know is this, is that no matter what you're going through, you need to know that the Lord, amen, will minister unto your heart and your soul. But listen, what you need to know is this: you and I got to understand the things of God. You can't just take my word for whatever it is that I tell you. And listen to me, we have to learn the things of God. Amen. One of the things that we're going to talk about in the book of Proverbs tonight is wisdom. Amen. Yes. Proverbs is all about wisdom. As a matter of fact, Proverbs chapter 4, verse 7. We'll see if Sandy can keep up on the screen. If not, we have some Bibles in the back there on the table. She's faster than I am. Wisdom chapter 4, verse 7. It says, wisdom is the principal thing, therefore get wisdom, and with all thy getting, get understanding. Now, what the proverb is saying is that wisdom is the chief thing. It's really the same word that would be utilized to describe first fruits. Now, I want to just real quick, in other words, the way that Solomon is describing wisdom is that it's so important that you can't really plan to live your life in any way, shape, or form if you don't get it. He goes on to talk in other spots about the fact that wisdom is like a treasure. It's better than silver. It's better than gold. It's better than rubies. It must be sought after. And so when we look at wisdom in general, what we're talking about is this is knowledge that is coming from God to his people. Now, I can tell you right now, we'll go through a couple of scriptures, but you're going to run into various types of people. You're going to run into people who, number one, don't know anything about God. And when you try to talk to them about the Bible, unless the Holy Spirit anoints your words, really and truly, you'll run into some people, man, they don't know the Lord. The Holy Spirit will anoint your words and they will be engaged and they will want to hear more. And I don't care how much the Holy Spirit's moving, there's some people, at least I've seen it, there's some people that you can sit there and I know the Holy Spirit's trying to deal with their heart and it's just like falling straight down on the ground because they have no desire whatsoever for anything having to do with God or anything having to do with the wisdom of God. You can also have people in the church who are saved, or they say they're saved. I believe I was saved, and had no delight in the wisdom of God, had no hunger for the things of God, did not see the wisdom of God as a treasure. And one of the things that I realize now is that I can't live, amen, without the wisdom of God in the midst of my life. Now, I do want to just take a real quick moment. Proverbs chapter 8, verse 22. There's a spot right here that some commentators and scholars would say that this right here is actually talking about Jesus. I'm not going to make a big point about this, but I am going to make a point about it. In Proverbs 8, 22, it says, "The Lord possessed me in the beginning of his way before his works of old. I was set up from everlasting, from the beginning, or ever the earth was. When there were no depths, I was brought forth. When there were no fountains abounding with water, before the mountains were settled, before the hills was I brought forth. While as yet he had not made the earth, nor the fields, nor the highest part of the dust of the world, when he prepared the heavens, I was there. When he set a compass upon the face of the depth, when he established the clouds above, when he strengthened the fountains of the deep, when he gave to the sea his decree, and the waters should not pass his commandment, when he appointed the foundations of the earth, then I was by him as one brought up with him, and I was daily his delight, rejoicing always before him. Now, once again, we're not going to try to make a huge distinction to say that this is undoubtedly Jesus, but let me just try to explain something to you. One of the things that we talked about whenever recently was out of the book of Colossians, and also out of the book of Hebrews, and also out of the book of John. In those three places, there is distinctly the concept that the eternal Word, which is the same as the eternal Son, spoke the world into existence. It says it in Colossians 1:13. It says it in John chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. Nothing that was made without Him. The eternal Word. You got to understand that there is a clear distinction in the Godhead. I don't understand it all, and neither do you. And the greatest of scholars, I've listened to some of them. They will admit to you, I can't understand it all, but I know that there's one God, and He's made up of three distinct personalities. And He's one in unity, and the Father has a plan, and the Son is the eternal Word that spoke the plan into existence, and He was the second person of the Godhead. And in the Godhead councils of eternity, the second person of the Godhead who spoke the worlds into existence clothed Himself, tinted Himself in human flesh, and He came upon this earth He came upon this earth in the likeness of sinning flesh, but never yielded to sin, and offered up His sinlessness upon the cross in payment for the penalty of our sin. Yeah. So the point that I'm trying to make is this, is that there's this idea here that wisdom is personified. Wisdom is saying, I was there with Him in the creation. Whenever it came time to create, I was brought forth. Now the Jehovah's Witnesses, they're liars. Don't let them into your house unless you call me up, because I like to talk to them, okay? I'm telling you, don't let them in. It's a mess. But we'll deal with them. If you call me up, we will definitely deal with them, all right? But what they will say is that where it says about brought forth, that it's saying that Jesus, because they believe it, it's talking about Jesus too. They'll say, see, He was created. No, it doesn't say anything about He was created right there. It said when it time to bring forth creation, I was brought forth. Amen. Anyway, the Word spoke. Hallelujah. The main point I'm trying to make to you is this. Wisdom is the principal thing. It's the chief thing. But you and I understand as New Testament Christians, you cannot even begin to understand the wisdom of God until you first have an encounter and a relationship with the eternal Word that spoke the world into existence. Hallelujah. Amen. And you and I also know that in the New Testament, it's real clear. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14 says that the natural mind cannot perceive the things of God. You try to have a logical conversation with somebody that does not really know the things or the ways of God, and it will be the most frustrating thing that you've ever seen in all of your life, because they cannot believe in the supernatural. They cannot take a step of faith to believe in something that they cannot see. The Word of God says in Ephesians 5:18, Paul was praying for the church of Ephesus, praying that the eyes of their understanding would be enlightened. See, you and I need God to open up the eyes of our understanding so that you and I can begin to understand the concept of the wisdom of God. Amen? Right. And that's what the Scriptures go on to tell us. It says that Jesus told Nicodemus in John chapter 3, verse 3, unless a man is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God, nor can he enter into the kingdom of God. So you and I understand that if wisdom is the principal thing, and this scripture here is telling me that wisdom, I believe, in some way, shape, or form is connected to Jesus. I may not be able to explain it all to you, but I know that Jesus is wisdom. Hallelujah, because Jesus is the Word. Amen. He was clothed in a vesture dipped dipped in blood. Hallelujah. And his name is the Word of God. That's who Jesus is. And so when we get to know the Word, we get to know Jesus. And he is the physical manifestation of the invisible God. God chose to send Jesus upon this earth to live out his life in such a way that it would be played on a stage for human eyes to view, documented in this book, so that you and I can see how he responded and how he handled various circumstances. But this is the thing. See, as we move forward in all this wisdom, one of the things that you got to understand is this. You will never accomplish any of this wisdom in your own strength. You can know all the wisdom, you can have all the knowledge, and the reality of it is, if you don't have the wisdom and how to properly walk with the Lord, and to understand where the object of your faith must Amen. Be forever placed, Amen, is squarely in Jesus Christ and what he accomplished for you on the cross. Now, let me explain something to you real quick. Why is that so important? Because I've had conversations, Robert would testify to the fact that there's been people that have told us, man, you people need to move past the cross. And you know, why is it so important that you would continue to maintain your faith in what Jesus has done for you at the cross? Because I want to explain something to you. When you put your faith in what Christ did for you at the cross, a transition took place. See, this is faith right here. It took faith. And so when you were born dead of Adam, when you put faith in what Christ did for you at the cross, something happened. You got translated. The Word of God says in Colossians 1:13, you were translated from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his dear Son. Now, whenever that happened, you got to understand that before you gave your heart to Jesus, you had a cloud, if you will, of condemnation and guilt that constantly loomed and hung over your head. Amen? Amen. But now that you're in Christ, you now have a different kind of cloud. I'm running out of chalk, but you have a different kind of cloud, and it's called righteousness. Because you've been clothed with the righteousness of Christ. And because you've been clothed with the righteousness of Christ, and you're no longer guilty, now you have access.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Access to grace.
Amen.
Grace is a change agent.
Yes.
It's a divine change agent. God's influence on the life. When grace is poured out by the person of the Holy Spirit into your life, he begins to accomplish things in you that you couldn't accomplish in your own self. You can't work yourself up into a lather and try to know all the wisdom that the Proverbs speak of and then try to engage in it in your own strength. No, you and I need proper faith in what Christ has done, allowing us to be clothed with the righteousness of him, hallelujah, which now gives us access to the presence of God, which changes us on a daily
Amen.
Basis. You probably hear me say that every time I preach, because you can't continue, you can't hear it enough times.
Yeah.
Amen. That's how God has chosen for this to work. Amen. This is the plan of redemption, hallelujah, where the exchange took place. You need to believe that tonight.
Yes.
The enemy of your soul wants to keep you under a cloud of condemnation
yes.
and guilt. He wants to make you feel guilty and unworthy. I'm here to tell you tonight, if you got Jesus living in your heart, you're not guilty and unworthy.
Amen.
No,
Amen.
You put faith in Christ. And now you've been pronounced innocent by God. Now you've been pronounced righteous by God. And because of that, hallelujah, you have access to grace. Amen?
Amen.
And so one of the things I also want you to realize is that the Proverbs are kind of like parables. Now, whenever I taught on parables before, I explained to you that the word parable was made up of two Greek words, and it means para is a preposition, which means side, and below is kind of like where we get our word ball, it means throw. And so you throw two things side by side for the purpose of comparison and contrast, all right? And so where Solomon says in Proverbs chapter 1, verse 6, Solomon says in Proverbs chapter 1, verse 6, to understand a proverb and the interpretation, the words of the wise and their dark sayings. Now, the word dark sayings in the King James, it kind of gives the idea of something real mystical or almost kind of like evil. That's not the idea. It has mystery connected to it because it's like a puzzle. See, whenever Jesus would teach in parables, he did it for a purpose. Because he actually quoted one time what the prophet Isaiah said, that what God told the prophet Isaiah, that seeing they may see, hearing they may hear, unless if they did see and they did hear, then they would be converted. There's, this is the truth. Not everybody really wants the truth. You see, some people act like they want the truth, but they don't really want the truth. Yeah. God knows. He determines the heart of man. He knows the motives of man. Yeah. And so when Jesus would speak in parables, it wasn't for the whole crowd to be able to understand. He even told the disciples that when he brought them up on the mountain. He said, "To you I speak plainly. To them I speak in parables that they might not understand." And so the dark sayings that he's talking about is like a puzzle. See, the truth of the matter is that when it comes to the wisdom of God, Solomon talks about over and again that it's like a treasure. And it has to be sought after. See, the Proverbs, whenever you read through them, you can say, "Oh man, I read the whole book of Proverbs today." Well, you didn't really read it. Because when it comes to the Proverbs, you got to sit and ponder. You got to sit and contemplate. I mean, if you really want to try to grab the wisdom that's coming out of there, you have to try to work with it to try to understand it. Now, one example that I want to give you is like when Jesus spoke in parables. Because once again, Jesus spoke in parables, and in a similar sense, proverbs are similar to parables. You remember the parable of the prodigal son? Whenever Jesus talked about what the prodigal son did and how he had taken all of his wealth from his father and he went off and he squandered everything and then he came back. Remember, he had ended up in the pigsty and he realized what he was, the mess he was in, and he brought himself back to the father, and the father welcomed him, put a ring on his finger and a robe on his back. And then the older brother said, "I never left once, and you never killed no fatted calf for me." Jesus prepared that whole story for one purpose: to show the Pharisees. He was throwing that in their face. He was revealing to them the intents of their own heart. All that story was a parable of showing and throwing alongside the life of a sinner that had not done what was he was supposed to do with God, but then when he's broken in the midst of his sin, he comes running back to God, that the heart of the Father receives him. Amen. And that the other brother was like a Pharisee who thought that he was doing what he was supposed to do the whole time, but his heart was hardened towards the things of God. Yeah. So Jesus prepared that whole thing just for them to be able to see really what the heart of God looked like. Amen. And so sometimes in the book of Proverbs, we're seeing these kinds of thoughts taking place. Amen. And so I want you to see too, we can turn to Proverbs chapter 9, verse 8. I wanted you to see that there's oftentimes different types of responses to wisdom, to the wisdom of God in general. It says in Proverbs chapter 9, verse 8, "Reprove not a scorner, lest he hate thee. Rebuke a wise man, and he will love thee." You know what a scorner is? A scorner is somebody that mocks. So reproof means correction. So if you try to bring correction into a mocker's life, somebody who doesn't really believe the things of God, somebody who doesn't really care about the things of God, likely the result, don't get surprised, I'm not saying you won't ever do it, just don't get surprised that the result of it is that they become angry with you. And it might not turn into a fist fight right then and there, but later on you might realize that when they see you at Walmart, they really don't want to talk to you that much. They don't really want to have a whole lot to do with you. Don't be surprised by that, because they're a mocker. They're not a person that really has the things of God in their heart. Amen. But it says right here that when you rebuke a wise man, he will love you. Now, I got to tell you, I hope that I got a little bit of wisdom. I can't promise you that if you rebuke me, that right there in that moment of time, that I'm going to be loving on you. But the truth of the matter is that as I seek the face of God, and as I allow myself to be humbled in the presence of God, I'm going to allow that thing to begin to work on the inside of me. And at some point in time, I'm going to realize if it was right and it was from the Lord, amen, I'm going to receive it, praise God. And sometimes, you know what, we're out of the will of God. People, whether it be me or you, sometimes we try to go around rebuking people, and it really wasn't the Lord's will that we did that. Because sometimes, you know what, this is something that the Lord put on my heart the other day. I'm realizing that we go through stages in our Christian understanding. Sometimes, you know, when it first starts off, we're like little babies, sucklings, right? All we can do is handle milk. That's what Paul said. He said, at the time when I would prefer to give you meat, all you can handle is milk, right? And so we're like babies, and we don't know anything. Really, we don't, if you think about it. I mean, when you first come to the Lord, you don't know nothing, right? But then as time goes forward, if you put any kind of effort into studying, you start growing up a little bit. And you know what I realize? We become adolescents. We become adolescents in the faith. Now you would think, oh man, that's a good thing. I'm growing. Yeah, well, if you'll remember how you were when you were a teenager, it wasn't really all that good. Because the truth of the matter is that you thought you knew everything, right? And you were ready to fight over something, trying to tell your mom and your daddy. At least that's how we do it over here in America. I don't know how they do it in other countries. They probably honor their mother and father like the Bible says. But in America, we got bad, sassy mouths and floppy lips, and we start thinking that we know something. And many times as a teenager in the faith, the same thing happens. Pride starts to rise up on the inside of us, and we start thinking that we know a little something, something. But that's okay. Hold on. Hold on to the faith. Keep on studying. Keep on going through the trial. The Lord knows how to knock you down a couple of steps. Amen. And sooner or later, we start to mature in the faith, and we start to realize, you know what? We don't know everything. Hallelujah. Other people got wisdom too, and I can learn how to listen to what they got to say. Amen. And hopefully every now and then they'll listen to something I got to say. Amen. And we learn to move in that particular direction. But you don't reprove a scorner unless if you're going to do it, you need to realize that he may end up hating you for it. Amen. Proverbs 26 verses 4 and 5. This is another response. Well, this is kind of like what the Holy Spirit's explaining to you and I when it comes to people's responses to wisdom. It says, "Answer not a fool according to his folly, lest thou also be like unto him. Answer a fool according to his folly, lest he be wise in his own conceit." It's like, it's an oxymoron. He's telling you the opposite thing. He's saying, don't answer a fool according to his folly. Don't even get caught up in that fool's business, man. Don't even waste your breath on him, because you're going to make yourself look silly like he is. But then he turns around and says, answer a fool according to his folly, unless he becomes, wise in his own conceit. So the idea is that it doesn't matter what you do with a fool. You can tell him the truth, or you can leave him alone. He's still going to be a fool by the time you're done with it. You're not going to fix him, amen, but at the same time, you're going to find yourself, if you're trying to fix him, in a frustrating situation, because it's not going to happen. And so it doesn't really matter what you tell a fool. Now, you know, to be fair to the fool, I know that I've been a fool at times. I know the Bible says, call no man a fool. But, you know, the truth of the matter is that if we're all honest with one another, there's been times that people have tried to speak into our lives and we weren't willing to listen. Yes. And that's basically what the Bible calls a fool. Somebody who's reproved, corrected, but stiffens his neck, hardens his heart, and refuses to hear the word of God. And the reality of it is that the parables actually, time and again, go back and forth with explaining or comparing the fool, the sluggard, the slothful to the wise, the righteous, those that love wisdom. Amen. And we see this going back and forth time and again. We've already talked about the fact that wisdom is seen as a great treasure. Now, I would like to talk real quick just about the idea of knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. I thought that this was good. One time I did a little teaching on it. And just kind of like understanding the difference between them helped me out a little bit, because, I mean, they're all very similar, but it's kind of like the way I felt like the Lord was showing me is that knowledge is just basically the information about the things of God. Amen? You and I, if we're fair to people, should be able to understand that when we first have conversations with people that know nothing about the things of God, and you start talking about Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, have you ever seen their eyes glaze over sometimes? I mean, I talk to a lot of people that don't know anything about the Bible. And so I find myself really backing up and slowing down and whatever the case. But, you know, you have to first familiarize yourself with the knowledge of God, the things about God. It's a whole other culture. Does that make sense? I know I've talked about that before, but if you're from South Louisiana, you know what crawfish are. Amen? But if you're from somewhere else and you've never seen crawfish, you might have just got introduced to one the other day. But the things of God come from another realm. The kingdom of God comes from another place. Amen? And so it's foreign to what we're used to. And so therefore we have to familiarize ourselves with the knowledge of God. And when we do familiarize ourselves with that, we begin to understand that God does things a whole lot different than we do. So then, now that we begin to learn the knowledge of God and how God handles things and his character, we actually are able now to begin to apply those things in our life. That's what wisdom is. Wisdom is the application of knowledge. Whenever I now know that God says that a soft answer turns away wrath. That's one of the scriptures I had in here out of Proverbs. So me and you are in the midst of a conversation and you say something to me that I don't really like, and I can feel something coming up on you. Come on, somebody. Tell me that you still got some emotions in you. Tell me that I'm not the only one now. But you say something to me and I can tell you're trying to jab me, man. You're trying to get me, because, you know, the fact of the matter is I'm perceptive, guy. I know when you're trying to get my goat. And you said something to me, boy, and I can feel it rising up on the inside of me. And the next thing I want to do is I want to hit you with something, right? I want to say something back to you. But the word of God says a soft answer turns away wrath. You know, I can know that all day long, but whenever you hit me with what you say, if I don't apply it in the midst of that situation, I'm not operating in wisdom. I just got some knowledge up here, but it's never been manifest in the midst of my life. What ended up happening is that as you begin to apply wisdom in your everyday lives, sooner or later you begin to gain understanding. And I believe that the word understanding and discretion work hand in hand. And what that basically means is that you start being able to perceive your environment and your situation in a whole different world. You're now operating with the understanding of the things of God. It's become part of your nature. It doesn't mean you get it right all the time, but you can perceive situations. You can tell circumstances that are probably about to go wrong, and the Lord's already dealing with you and giving you answers and how to handle the situation. Amen. And the more we practice applying the wisdom of God and the word of God in these situations, the more understanding of God we begin to have, and the more it begins to affect our lives. Amen. All right. So let's see. Well, I wanted to kind of go over a couple of things here. Like, first of all, the parable nature of the Proverbs is that typically you can just pull a verse out and it can stand alone. Usually when we study the Bible, we have to study everything in context, right? When you study a whole chapter, because in the Gospels, the whole chapter is a story and it means something. In the Proverbs, it's not really necessarily like that. A lot of times you can pull a verse out and it stands alone. But I will tell you that in my opinion, in Proverbs 7 and 8, these are a large volume of parable that are connecting two things. The two things that we're comparing here is wisdom, and she's being personified as a woman. And we're also comparing this wisdom woman to a harlot. Now, this harlot is not to be noticed as a literal harlot, but in reality, we could say she represents false religion. We could say she represents false doctrine. But really, what she represents overall is just the wrong way. She represents us traveling in the wrong direction other than towards the wisdom of God, which is the way of God. And as New Testament saints, we understand proper faith in God's redemption plan gives us grace and allows us to access wisdom that gives us the strength that we need to navigate this world that we live in. All right. So in chapter 8 of verse 1, starting in verse 1, this is talking about wisdom. And this is what it says. It says, "Does not wisdom cry, and understanding put forth her voice? She stands in the top of high places, by the way in the places of the paths. She cries at the gates, at the entry of the city, at the coming in at the doors. Unto you, O men, I call, and my voice is to the sons of man. O ye simple, understand wisdom, and ye fools, be ye of an understanding heart. Hear, for I will speak of excellent things, and the opening of my lips shall be right things. For my mouth shall speak truth, and wickedness is an abomination to my lips. All the words of my mouth are in righteousness. There is nothing froward," another word for pervert or perverse, "in them. They are all plain to him that have understanding, and right to them that find knowledge." Now, the main part I wanted you to see is that, once again, wisdom is being personified as a woman. But look where she is. Start back at verse 1. She cries, she puts forth her voice, she stands in the top of the high places, and by the way, in the places of the paths. When the word way there is descriptive of crossroads, the idea is basically that wisdom isn't trying to hide herself. Wisdom stands at the high place, and she stands at the crossroads where all of the people get together and all the commerce takes place. See, we're a little bit different in this nation. Now we're in our modern times. We get in our car and we drive to the store. But in underdeveloped countries, or even in these ancient times, people would come to the city gates. They would find crossroads in the path, and people would meet there. And so essentially what we're being told here is that wisdom shows up where people are. And she's not trying to hide herself. She's out there in the open, and she's walking around, and she's saying, "Hey, you who are simple, won't you come over here and won't you learn of me?" As a matter of fact, let's go to chapter 1, verse 20, and there's a little bit more information like that right there. Proverbs chapter 1, verse 20. It says, "Wisdom cries without. She utters her voice in the streets. She cries in the chief place of concourse," talking about where all the people are, "like in the markets, in the openings of the gates." That's where people did all their business. "In the city, she utters her words, saying, 'How long, ye simple ones, will you love simplicity? And the scorners," or another word for mockers, "delight in their mocking, and fools hate knowledge. Turn at my reproof and my correction. Behold, I will pour out my spirit unto you. I will make known my words unto you, because I have called and you refused. I have stretched out my hand and no man regarded, but you have set at naught all my counsel, and would have none of my reproof. I also will laugh at your calamity. I will mock when your fear comes." Once again, she's in the open. Wisdom's crying in the open. She's in the middle of the daylight. She's at the concourse. She's at the shopping market. She's in the way. No matter where you go, all of your life, you can try to run from God all you want to. Come on, somebody, help me out here. When you've been in the darkest places of your life, then the most unlikely circumstances, God will send somebody over there to you to speak a word to you and to remind you of Him. And He's saying, "Come unto me, simple one. Won't you hear my voice? I'm out here in the broad daylight. I'm screaming forth the truth of God." All right, now let's go to chapter 7. We'll just start reading. Now this is Solomon writing here. Solomon, it seems as though to me he's teaching his son in verse 1. He says, "My son, keep my words and lay up my commandments with thee. Keep my commandments and live, and my law is the apple of thine eye." It means your pupil, it means protect it. You would protect your pupil, wouldn't you? Of course you would. So the word, the commandments are representative. The commandments and the law, representative of God's word for the Old Testament Israel. He's saying, protect my word like it's the pupil of your eye. Bind them on your fingers. Write them on the table of your heart. Say unto wisdom, "You are my sister." Call understanding your kinswoman, that they may keep you from the strange woman, from the stranger which flatters with her words. This is, now he begins to tell a story. And so Solomon's at, it's as though he's on one of the porches of his house, and he's looking through some lattice or something, and he's watching this young man go down the road, and she is the opposite of wisdom. She's a harlot, and everything's being done in disguise. Everything's being done in darkness, and she's appealing to the sensual flesh, and she's trying to get him to go in the wrong direction. And Solomon seems to be watching this whole thing. He says, "For at the window of my house I looked through my casement and beheld among the simple ones, I discerned among the youths, a young man void of understanding, passing through the street near her corner, and he went the way to her house in the twilight, in the evening, in the black and dark night. And behold, there met him a woman with the attire of a harlot and subtle of heart." Subtle of heart meaning that she was full of trickery and deceit. And what's interesting to me is that it never says she truly was a harlot. It says she has the attire of a harlot. So I don't really understand. It's like she's disguising herself as a harlot. And then it goes on to say, "She is loud and stubborn. Her feet abide not in her house. Now is she without, now in the streets, and lies in wait at every corner. So she caught him and kissed him, and with an impudent face said unto him, 'I have peace offerings with me. This day I have paid my vows.'" She's doing religion. She's going through the rote religion of the law. She takes care of the peace offerings. She's paying her vows. But here she is in the darkness of night with deception and trickery, trying to move it. That right there is definitely a play on false doctrine, a play on a false way. that there's all kinds of people out there that are preaching a certain message, and it will lead you astray. It will bring you into darkness because it does not bring you into the truth where the light is, where wisdom is truly crying out and telling the truth of God's word. And the modern church is full of it. Therefore came I forth to meet thee diligently to seek thy face, and I have found you. I can tell you that the enemy is diligent. He's a whole lot more diligent than most Christians are. And he will not quit. He will not stop. And he is constantly looking to bring trickery. I have decked my bed with coverings of tapestry, with carved works, with fine linen of Egypt. See, she's appealing wickedness, perversion, appealing to the sensual appetite. I have perfumed my bed with myrrh, aloes, and cinnamon. Come, let us take our fill of love until the morning. Let us solace ourselves with loves, for the good man is not at home. He has gone on a long journey. I can remember one time whenever the Lord first got a hold of my heart. I can remember there was something that I mean, it's not important what it was. Like Brother Larson says, eat off your own plate because you got your own sin to deal with, right? But before the Lord began to give me a revelation of the cross, I can remember I premeditatedly was going to do some sin. And I can remember for a fleeting moment the thought of Jesus passed in front of my mind. But that's about how fast it was. It just that fast. And I quickly just like let it go out the other side. And you know, it was probably a year later, maybe 15 months later, that all the tragedy happened and the Lord really broke me down and began to speak to me about where I was at that moment in time. And he reminded me of that specific circumstance when I was reading this proverb, right here. And what he showed me was this. He said, that was me. I was the good man. I had gone on a long journey. Your sin had taken you so far away from me that you couldn't even feel my presence anymore. And you were so easily able to slip back into doing whatever sin. And no matter how, you know, here I am talking to you, pleading with you, but yet you've allowed yourself to get so far away and your heart to become so hardened that you were willing to continue to go in the direction that you were going in. And so I just wanted to show you that this is, to me, a big point in the book of Proverbs, that we're seeing that wisdom is personified as a woman who would be nurturing, caring, who's out in the open, in the middle of the daylight, God's truth, amen. God brought light into the midst of darkness. Jesus is the light, hallelujah. The darkness did not comprehend him or couldn't apprehend him, really is what it means in the Greek. In other words, the darkness could not overcome Jesus, praise God. But this is being compared and contrasted to the wrong way. That there's a deceptive way, whether it be false doctrine or the ways of sensuality, that are going to pull mankind away from the things of God, away from the wisdom of God. All right. And so now, you know, there's a whole lot that we could talk about when it comes to wisdom. I mean, as far as in the book of Proverbs, we could talk about, you know, how wisdom can help us raise our children. I've been talking about that a lot lately. It just kind of comes out in the last few services I've preached about not sparing the rod and, you know, all this kind of stuff like that. But there's two things that I felt like the Lord put on my heart that I wanted to kind of talk about a little bit. And it's really kind of practical. But I'll be honest, and you know, I don't have a problem with practical Christianity. I really don't. As long as we understand that you cannot accomplish any of these practical Christianity points without first understanding how you gain your strength from God. Because listen, whereas my problem may have been whether it was doing drugs, drinking, running around, trying to live the party, if that was my problem, maybe that wasn't your problem. Maybe your problem was gossip, lying, backbite. Okay, maybe your problem was spending too much money at Dillard's. I'm telling on myself. Maybe I still got that problem. Maybe your problem was, you understand what I'm saying, spending too much money, not handling your affairs properly. Guess what? That stuff can turn into like a sin. That stuff can turn into like a stronghold. You understand what I'm saying? You'd be like a crack addict looking for a pipe. You got to go spend some more money. It don't matter how much money you do spend, you ain't spend enough. You understand what I'm getting at? You can't stop. It's almost like you start to use it in such a way, it's almost like you get an adrenaline rush and you release endorphins in your brain by spending money on yourself or somebody else that you love. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Yeah. It makes you feel good. I bought some stuff, right? And so what I'm just trying to say is that you need the help of the cross just as much in that situation as you do all those other things that I listed. Amen. I mean, I'm glad for you if you never had a problem with drugs, man. I give you a knuckle bump right there. That's good for you. If you never put your lips on a can of beer, put drugs in your body, man, praise God. You were smart.
Yeah.
But you got something you've been dealing with, and you need to understand how to access grace through proper faith. Amen.
Yeah.
All right. So right now we're going to focus on some financial type stuff. And I'm just saying finances overall because there's a lot of different aspects to these proverbs. So in Proverbs chapter 3, verses 9 and 10, the first thing it says right here is, honor the Lord with your substance and with the first fruits of all your increase. So shall thy barns be filled with plenty, and thy presses shall burst out with new wine. So what is that talking about? That's talking about the first fruit is a tithe offering. So even in the Old Testament, whenever they would bring their harvest in, they would have to take a tithe of the harvest and they'd have to bring it to the house of God. The tithe was instituted long before the law ever was. We're not going to get into all that right now. But what I'm here to tell you is, and don't get mad at the preacher for telling you the truth. It's my job to tell you the truth.
Amen.
That God requires of his people the tithe.
Yes.
I pay my tithe. I pay my tithe to the church. Amen? And I thank God that I have a good job and it helps. Praise God. And I don't have to take a salary from the church. Praise God at where we are at this point in juncture. Amen? And so, but the point of it is that I can tell you that when I first came into the faith, that wasn't the first thing I wanted to do was pay a tithe.
Amen.
People first off say, how in the world can I pay a tithe? My question is, how in the world can you not pay a tithe?
Amen.
You see, sometimes people don't understand why they have holes in their pockets, but it's because they're going against what the Word of God says. But you don't understand, preacher. I have a very serious financial situation going on. Good. Trust the Lord in this. The Lord said, put me to the test in the book of Malachi. See that I will not open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you are unable to contain. This is another place that requires submission on the part of the believer to trust God that he's bigger than your financial situation, to trust God that he's bigger than money. And let me tell you, money talks, bro, because I'm over there working for the money. Amen? I don't even know how many patients I saw today, but it seemed like I saw 25 this morning. It seemed like it was never going to stop. I was like, oh Lord, I had patients in all my other doctor's hallways. I had to tell them when I was leaving the office, I got patients down this hallway, I got patients down that hallway, I got patients everywhere. Okay, and it was, but you know what? Praise the Lord. I thank God that I got a job, amen, and that I got a job to go to, and then I can work, hallelujah. But listen to me, I'm telling you, the first time I paid a tithe, it was a whole lot less than what it is today. And some people are like, I've seen it, where some people are cool paying tithes and they start getting raises. It's like, man, that's a lot of money. Yeah. Well, thank God the Lord blessed you.
Amen.
He brought you along to this place. And if it wouldn't be for the Lord in the midst of your life, then where would you be? Amen. And so I want you to know that that's the first thing. Honor the Lord with your first fruits. Give unto God. Amen. You need to give unto God. You need to trust God in the midst of that situation. He says, if you'll do that, your barns will be filled with plenty. And your presses shall burst out with new wine. And your wine press, just wine, you have so much grapes in your wine press, and just wine's going to be pouring out. And the first question that people, I'm not preaching no prosperity message here now. I'm trying to tell you the truth. Now, God will prosper his people.
Amen.
But the next question that people have to ask is this. Well then, preacher, I've been paying my tithes. And the question is, why in the world don't I see wine pouring out of my wine press?
Amen.
All right, well, guess what? There's more to the story. There's more than just paying God what belongs to him.
Amen.
There's other things that have to take place. Amen? Good old practical wisdom out of the book of Proverbs. All right, here we go. Proverbs chapter 6, verse 6. Now, I know I'm not talking to anybody in this church tonight. I know I'm not. They stayed at home. I'm telling you. It says, go to the ant, you sluggard. Consider her ways and be wise. Now, the sluggard is a person that's lazy. Sluggard is a person who's really been away from the concept of work for so long The best way I know how to describe this concept is that, you know, and I'm not proud of this, but I used to smoke pot. And, you know, when you smoke pot, you know what the first thing to go is? Come on, Robert, shout it out there. Give me a shout out.
Desire to work.
Dude, desire to work is the first thing that's hit from smoking dope. You don't want to hit, you don't want to hit. Now, some people are like, that ain't me, dude. I used to smoke a doobie and I go work out like a madman. That doesn't happen to most people. Most people, when they smoke pot, all of their desire to go to work is left, and they just sit there on the couch and they flip through ESPN or they flip through whatever it is that they're watching, and they have no desire whatsoever. You don't even need marijuana for that to happen. I'm just here to tell you, you stay away from work long enough, and that slumber will come over you, and you will be known as what the Word of God. Now listen to me, everybody's got different situations. Sometimes people get hurt, they can't work, various things are taking place. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about people that are well able-bodied and can get up and can go do what it is that they need to do. They get caught, and especially in the society that we live in today. This society is more than happy to help people to prevent them from having to go to work. The Word of God says, hey, sluggard, consider the end. Now, what do we need to consider about the end? Yeah. It says that we need to consider her ways. She has no guide, overseer, or ruler. Which, having no guide, overseer, or ruler, provides her meat in the summer and gathers her food in the harvest. She doesn't have a boss looking over her shoulder. But if you'll watch a trail of ants, you'll see the same thing. They never stop. They're relentless. And you see how much food they're carrying. They carry like three times their weight, and they're over there, and nobody's telling them to do it. And, you know, there's something to our work ethic that means something right there, right? I mean, one of the things that I learned is that when I first started working, I didn't really have much work ethic. All of a sudden, though, after I started giving my heart to Jesus, I remembered my daddy, even though he didn't really serve the Lord. I think he gave his heart to God at the end there, but he didn't serve the Lord, but he used to talk about work a lot. And he'd say, you don't run away from it, boy, you run to it. And I didn't really know what that meant, but after the Lord started getting a hold of my heart, and I started hearing how them supervisors would kind of talk about people that seemed like they were laying up, man, I'm telling you, it's like I just wanted to give everything. Like, what can I do now, boss, you know? And people were calling me all kind of names and all this stuff. But, you know, it's like when the Lord got a hold of me, I started to realize something happened in my spirit, and it says it in the book of Ephesians, that you have a master in heaven. You're working for Jesus, amen. He's watching the work that you do. And then God help you if you ever try to start a business, and especially if it doesn't work out. Because you're going to learn real quick that you know, the best thing that did for me when I started a business that didn't work out is that I started to want to work for my employer as though I was an owner. And to give everything that I had. Because I'm answering to God, and my work ethic is a reflection on the Jesus that I proclaim to me.
Amen.
And so I just want to encourage you with that. Go to the ant sluggard and consider her work. Consider her work ethic. All right, Proverbs chapter 10. So not only do we have to give the Lord the first fruit, amen, not only do we have to have a good work ethic, but also it says in Proverbs chapter 10, verse 4 and 5, it says, he becometh poor that dealeth with a slack hand, but the hand of the diligent makes rich. He that gathers in the summer is a wise son, but he that sleepeth in harvest is a son that causes shame. There's a time to go to work. The time when it's harvest time, you don't go lay on the couch. That's when it's time to go to work, amen? And there's also a time of storing up. And one of the things that I'm taken from this text is that just as they would take the foods and whatever the grain and whatever the case, and they would put it in the storehouse. And I know we got some people in here that can okra and different things like that. You store that stuff up. It takes work to put all that stuff together. And now you have a cupboard full of food that you can't grow okra in the dead of the wintertime, but now you got some in the cupboard. You just go reach over there when you're ready for some okra. The idea is this. Is that we got to learn how to save too. You see, and there's another scripture that's going to come up, and I hate to admit it, but there's still some of that in me. And I can work hard all I want to. I can say, hey, I considered the ant, I don't want to be a sluggard, and I'm going to work just as hard if my boss is watching my back as if I'm not, and I'm going to give the first fruits of all my increase unto the Lord, and I know that God's hand of blessing is on my life, but there's still, and dude, I'm telling you, I want to save. And I do save. But I'm not saving like I should. I'm just being honest with you. I'm being real with you. Amen? I think that, and part of the problem is, well, let's get to it. We'll get to it in a second. All right, let's go to Proverbs chapter 27. This is another important thing. And I think that, I'm just being transparent tonight. This is another place that I think that I've failed. I missed the mark. Proverbs 27:23. It says, "Be thou diligent to know the state of thy flocks and look well to thy herds." In other words, you need to know what you have. Amen? You need to be aware of what you have. This situation is a whole lot better in me than it used to be. When I first got a job and moved down here, man, I had a checkbook. And you know how I balanced my checkbook? I called the bank up and asked them how much money I had. That don't fly, dude, because all them checks didn't come in yet. And I'm over there trying to balance my checkbook based upon the information that they're giving me because I'm not keeping track of what I'm doing. No, you got to know what you have. If you don't know what you have, you're going to overspend. And when you overspend, you're going to get yourself in a bind. Amen?
Amen.
All right. It says in Proverbs chapter 16, verse 26. I like this verse. In Proverbs 16, verse 26, it says, "He that labors, labors for himself, for his mouth craves it of him." And you got to think about that for a second. And the reason that, you know, I think that this is so good is because you've ever been around people that complain all the time at work?
No.
Oh, man, look. You're going to complain about the boss, complain about the equipment, complain about the people that you work with, you know, and everything. Like, and half the time it's like, man, I'm working for the man, dude. The man's just trying to hold me down. He doesn't want me to get ahead. And what the proverb said right there is, "He that labors, labors for himself because his mouth craves it of him." No, the reality of it is you aren't working for the man. You're working to feed your mouth so that you can feed your belly, so that you can feed the people that are around you. Now, you might be able to do better if you go find another job, if you think so. But the reality of it is that I learned this also. I've known a whole lot of people that changed a whole lot of jobs through the years. And sooner or later, we got to start catching on to the fact that it might not be everybody else's problem. It might be your problem. Amen. The fact is that to some extent, with time, especially as Christians, we should learn some level of submission and some ability to be able to humble ourselves, to allow ourselves to be humbled. I'm not saying that everything's going to be perfect at work, but listen to me. If you're going to be a good worker, and if you're going to allow your life to be a reflection of the Lord, you got to be careful about what you say out of your mouth.
Amen.
I'm telling you right now, I catch myself sometimes, starting to say the wrong thing. I very seldom do I do it, but when I do, I'm like, you know what? No, I shut it down because it's not the right thing to do.
Yes.
You sit there and complain in front of other people and you start to cause a spirit of negativity to
Amen.
Take place
Amen.
And it causes a mess in the midst of it. It's bad enough whenever you're busy and you're crazy and you're running around, you're trying to keep things going right, and then you start talking trash, man, and it's like you, and then the people that don't know Jesus, man, you're just like pushing them way down. You know what I'm saying? No, if we're the ones that know the Lord and this is the job where the Lord has placed us, listen, this is a dress rehearsal for eternity. We labor because our mouth craves it. And that's why we're working. We're not just working for the man, but while we're there, amen, our work should be a reflection of the God that we serve.
Amen.
In Proverbs chapter 21, verse 5, it tells us, this is more about spending. Proverbs 21:5 says, "The thoughts of the diligent tend only to plenteousness, but of everyone that is hasty, only to want." What does that mean?
Wow.
It means you need to think things through.
Amen.
Amen. You don't need that. You wake up one morning, you decide, man, I want that, and you hurriedly go over there and you buy it. Then you're like, oh man, I wish I wouldn't have done that. You don't want to do things in haste. You want to take time. You really want to think it through. You want to, you know, you don't want to put yourself in a predicament like that. But if you're diligent and you really think it through and you use wisdom on how to handle your finances, then you'll find yourself in a situation where you're not in the bind like you would be if you did it this way. In Proverbs 21:17, this, I hate to say it, but to some extent, this is me right here. Proverbs 21:17, he that loves pleasure shall be a poor man. He that loves wine and oil shall not be rich. Now, I'm not telling you I don't love wine. I'm not over there a wine bibber drinking wine on the side. What it's talking about is wine and oil were expensive or things that cost money. And so sometimes, like, if you like nicer things, you know, and you're willing to spend money on it, that's less money than you're saving, right? And so, and I'm not saying that you can't spend money on yourself. What I'm saying is that you got to be diligent about the way that you think those things through, amen? And that you don't spend so much time spending money on yourself that you're not also saving, amen? And that you're, you know, you're not losing your money in that fashion. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I'm telling on myself a whole lot tonight, aren't I? I mean, y'all are looking at me like, what are you up there preaching for? You need to let me come preach. All right. Let's see here. Proverbs, I like Proverbs chapter 20, verse 4. This is some good stuff right here. It says, the sluggard will not plow by reason of the cold. Therefore shall he beg and harvest and have nothing. This is excuses. Everybody's got an excuse, right? Why they don't want to go to work, why they don't want to do this, why they can't get that done. You know, I can remember my dad complaining about people always having excuses, you know, and it's like, boy, just keep your mouth shut and go figure it out. Get it done. If you can't get it done, find somebody that can. You know, quit giving me all this lip and all these excuses. I don't want to hear it no more. Get it done. And so that's one thing. It's too cold outside. I don't want to go plow. And look at chapter 22. I like this one. Chapter 22, verse 13. It says, the slothful man says, there is a lion without. I shall be slain in the streets. Ain't no lion in the street, man. Come on, dude. Get up out the bed and go to work. You got to say there's a lion in the street. Go and get it. You know, no, man's always coming up with some kind of excuse why he doesn't want to go to work. Let's see what Proverbs 25:19 says. You know people like that, though, right? People at work. Every time you turn around, that grandma done died four times. You know, it's like, hold on a second. How many grandmas you got? They got an excuse why they're not showing up at work, right? All right, Proverbs 25:19. Confidence, this is how the boss looks at it. Alright, that's what we just looked at was how the sluggard looked at it. It's too cold or there's a lion out the street. This is how the boss looks at it. Confidence in an unfaithful man in time of trouble is like a broken tooth and a foot out of joint. Now, you got to take a little time to think about that for a second. What do you think of when you think of a broken tooth?
Useless.
I think of pain. If you break a tooth off at the level where the nerves exposed, it's painful. Yep. Now, a lame foot, that's what I think. Useless. You can't walk on a lame foot. You can't do it. It's not doing you any good. So a broken tooth and a lame foot is something that's painful and it's useless. And so basically what's happening in this situation is to a boss, when you have confidence in an unfaithful person, that's what it starts to feel like after a while. Oh, she called in again. He called in again. And it must just, like, I don't even know what they think after a while. It's like, we're better off without that. At some point in time, it gets to the point where, you know what, we're better off just sucking it up and doing it without that than to never know and never be able to plan anything and not know what to expect. You know what I'm saying? But anyway, thank God none of us are like that. Amen? All right. Now, real quick, I just got a few more verses. I think we'll be able to finish in a few minutes. This, I want to talk to you a little bit now about our relationship with others and specifically the way that we talk. So in Proverbs chapter 15:1 is the scripture that I quoted a little while ago that talks about the fact that a soft answer turns away wrath, but grievous words stir up anger. So when you speak grievous words, that means painful. You know, there's times that you and I probably know that if we say something to someone, that it could be painful to them. If we're saying it to hurt them, it's wrong. Sometimes certain things have to be said in situations to bring correction. But if our motives are pure and our desire is to help the person, that's one thing. But when we say painful words, grievous words to people in such a way to hurt them on purpose, then there's something wrong with what we're doing. But the fact of the matter is that even whenever people say that to us, the first initial response is for us to come back. Right? And what the Word of God's saying is that if we'll respond with a soft answer, it basically diffuses the situation. A soft answer turns away wrath. I don't know about you, but the older I get, I'm getting old. The older I get, I'm just tired of fighting all the time. I used to love a confrontation. Not that long ago. I'm telling you. Like last year. Last year, I was still loving confrontation. And I'm just starting to get more and more tired of it. The more it happens, the more confrontation. I used to want to correct everybody about their doctrine, man. I'm telling you right now. Don't get me wrong. I still will. I couldn't help it the other day at the garage sale. I had to ask that old boy, what made you go from a denomination where they were teaching you to the truth back to a denomination where they're telling you a lie? What made you do that? Oh, because that's what my grandpa was. You know what? I wish I wouldn't have. I shut my mouth, but I wish I wouldn't have, because what I wanted to tell him was, sir, your grandpa didn't die for your sin. But I had gotten to the point where I felt like it was starting to turn into a mess, so I shut up a little bit. I tried not to go too far. But now, you know what? I felt like I let that old boy down. He needed to hear that. His grandpa didn't die for his sin. You know, leave. Oh, Lord help me. All right. So I guess maybe I still want to confront people. All right. Let's see. Proverbs 15:4. A wholesome tongue is a tree of life, but perverseness therein is a breach in the spirit. So, you know, you got one person that's speaking grievous words that'll stir up anger, and then a wholesome tongue, which is a pure tongue, speaking words of encouragement, strengthening somebody, can be a tree of life. We talked about that in that passage of Psalms, that the person who loves the law and the commandments is like a tree planted by the water. It will bring forth its fruit in due season. Amen. God will use you and I and people's lives to speak forth truth in the midst of their lives and to help build them up and to strengthen them in their life. Amen. All right. Proverbs 16:28. This is getting into gossip and strife. Proverbs 16:28, a froward man, that's another word for perverse, sows strife, and a whisperer separates chief friends. Got to be careful about that, you know, about how we talk, what we say, what we're saying about the person. Are we being malicious when we talk about people? Sometimes, you know, you may have a conversation about somebody, and you're talking about someone to someone else. I know sometimes Robert and I have conversations about people, and we end up praying for them, right? But the fact of the matter is that sometimes we can have conversations about people, and we're talking about them behind their back, and if we're doing that, if it gets back, you can't really fix that, yeah. And it causes some people are very offended very easily. Have you ever noticed that?
Yes.
Some people are offended very easily, and it says a brother easily offended is like it's hard to get them back, you know. And so I'm going to encourage you not to be easily offended. Don't let the least little thing that somebody does. You need to learn how to get a little bit tough skin, right? To where you realize that not everybody's perfect. Not everybody's going to do everything the way that you want them to do. Everything's not going to go exactly according to your set schedule and your plan. And the fact of the matter is that if you don't realize that and you don't toughen up a little bit, you're going to find yourself in the midst of a situation where you're going to end up quitting, you're going to end up getting frustrated, you're going to end up not wanting to cut. You hang around this church long enough, you're going to get offended. I guarantee you, you've already probably been offended. It ain't been coming for 2 weeks and somebody already did something you didn't like. And my point is that we're human beings.
Amen.
We're fallen creatures. We're not going to get it right all the time. Amen.
Amen?
But at the same time, we got to be careful that we're not over there with our tongue causing trouble. All right. Proverbs 26:21-22. As coals are to burning coals, and wood to fire, so is a contentious man to kindle strife. The words of a talebearer are as wounds, and they go down into the innermost parts of the belly. So basically, if a person, a contentious person, he wants to contend, he wants to keep going, he doesn't want to quit. Boy, I can tell you, there's been times I've been contentious. I'm just reading and I'm thinking about myself right now. And it's like, because, you know, I'm in the midst of a situation or a debate, and I just can't stop. And I'm over there, and if somebody would quit feeding the coal or the wood to the fire, the fire would go out.
Amen.
You know what
Amen.
I'm saying? And at some point in time, it's, you're not doing any good. You're not doing any good anymore whenever it's turned into a situation where it's literally become like a debate to the point where there's an argument. There's a such thing as a healthy theological debate, and then there's another thing where it turns into a big old mess, and it's nothing but, you know, that's what it is. It's a mess. And so somebody has to, I used to preach it like this. Some point in time, somebody's got to shut up. Whether it's in a marriage, whether it's in a friendship, whether it's somewhere, sooner or later, somebody's just got to close their lips, shut their mouth. And it doesn't always have to be the woman. Praise God. You know? I mean, I've had to learn that the hard way too. You know? Because when you grow up in the time when I grew up and how daddy was, boy, it's like, oh, we the man, right? We're gonna do things our way. No, it don't always have to be the woman. Sometimes you need to shut your mouth, man. And you need to learn humility. Amen. And Jesus kept his mouth quiet, right? Like a lamb led to slaughter, he did not open up his mouth. He didn't give him no lip back, you know, until the time when the Father would tell him. But we can learn something from Jesus, that we can learn some things. Amen. And it'll teach us something, man. It's good to learn humility. We don't always have to be right. Praise God. It's a hard thing to start realizing that you're not always right. All right. Proverbs 16:32. He that is slow to anger is better than the mighty, and he that ruleth his spirit than he that takes a city. I think of Jesus when I think of verses like this. Whenever they came to get him in the garden, and they said, he says, whom do you seek? They said, we seek Jesus of Nazareth. In the Greek, he said, I am. When he said, I am, they all fell down. All of them fell down under the power of God. He also tells them at one point in time, did you not know that I could call down, ask of my Father, and he would send a legion of angels? But yet what he did was he kept his mouth quiet and like a lamb led to the slaughter. And he went to the cross in the midst of all that, hung naked on the cross for our sin. Such humility. You know, you can't even really fathom it in your mind that he had all the power of God in him. And what he chooses instead to do is to meekly quiet himself and to just proceed forward with the plan of the Father. Amen? Now, I can tell you that in order to accomplish that, we need the fruit of the Spirit once again produced in our life. And the only way that the fruit of the Spirit can be produced in our life is if we remain abiding in the vine. Amen? And the way that we do that is through proper faith in what Christ has done for us at the cross. All right. Proverbs 17:14. See, once you start with strife, it's hard to stop it. The beginning of strife is as when one lets out water. Therefore, leave off contention before it be meddled with it. The idea is like a little crack in a dam. When you get a little crack in a dam and all that pressure of all that water is on that one little spot, once it happens, you aren't going to stick silly putty in there and stop it. It's just going to keep on coming. It's going to keep on coming and causing a bigger hole. The best thing to do is sometimes to leave it off. You know, and this is just to kind of like explain to you how what I take out of this from my own personal life. Not only was I a person that liked confrontation, I was also a person, I thought it was a noble thing about me, but I'm not so certain that it was anymore. I was also a person that didn't want to allow things to lie between us. If I thought that there was a problem between us, I immediately wanted to go to you and to try to make it right. Now, I know the scripture says that if your brother has aught against you, that you're to go to him. And that's true. But I don't think that I was really praying about the timing sometimes. You know what I'm saying? Because I think that part of me, I just can't hardly stand it when I feel like somebody's got a problem with me. So I think that there's a good part to that because I don't want me and you to be at odds with one another. You know what I'm saying? And I want to fix it, but I think that I just try to rush in too fast. The other person's probably not ready to deal with it yet. And that if I would have just backed up and waited a little bit and prayed a little bit and let me get my bearings about me, you know what I'm saying? Don't have to be a whole, because if you wait too long, you'll just blow it off and get hard towards it. But you know what I'm saying? That's kind of what I'm learning, man. It's like, just hold back a little bit, you know? All right, Proverbs chapter 17, verse 28. Look at this. Even a fool, when he holds his peace, is counted wise, and he that shuts his lips is esteemed a man of understanding. Sometimes it's just good to keep your mouth shut. Amen. And so that's what the Word of God says. Even a fool, man. Look, I know that dude's a fool, but boy, that was wise what he did right there. He just kept his mouth shut. He didn't open up his mouth right there. You know, something happened to me recently, and I'm not gonna get into it. Some of y'all know what it was. And when it first started to go down, I felt it in my spirit. Keep your mouth shut. Keep your mouth shut. And you know what? I did. And it turned it, and it was like that dam with that little crack, and it came off flowing out. So anyway, we need to learn. Sometimes it's just good to keep your mouth shut. Amen. All right. Proverbs 27:6, and then we're going to close with that. Amen. It says, faithful are the wounds of a friend, but the kisses of an enemy are deceitful. You know, sometimes your friends, people that you love, will say things to you, and it's going to hurt. But the truth of the matter is that if they're really your friend and they really care about you, they said it for a purpose, ultimately, to help you. You may not like the way they said it, because guess what? Sometimes they themselves are learning and growing. Amen? But if they really care about you, you'll know it. And sometimes whenever they say things, it's like a wound and it hurts. But if you'll really be willing to stop and learn, that's what I try to do in every situation when I have a confrontation or something that goes down. I always try to turn it back on Matt and try to evaluate, what did Matt do wrong? Where did Matt go wrong? Because the reality of it is that it wasn't all that other person's fault. I don't care, you know, if I was caught up in it, if they said something, if they see something in me and they're saying something about me, then the truth of the matter is that there may be at least a sliver of truth in what they're saying. And what I need to do is I need to back up and I need to find out if what they're saying is true. And if there's something there, I need to bring it to the Lord and ask the Lord to deal with my heart about it. Amen.